Good morning and welcome everyone to the 28th meeting of the Local Government and Communities Committee. Can I ask everyone to please ensure all the mobile phones are in silent? And just a reminder that broadcasting will operate your camera and microphone as usual. Please allow a short pause before being called on to speak to allow them to do so. We've received apologies today from Sarah Boyack. Polly McNeill is here as her committee substitute. Today's main business is oral evidence on building regulations and fire safety in Scotland, zero valued homes. But first, item one, with consideration of whether to take agenda items 5, 6, 7, and 8 in private. Item five is consideration of the evidence received in building regulations and fire safety. Item six is consideration of a revised draft letter to the Scottish Government on pre-budget scrutiny. Item seven is consideration of the analysis of responses and agreeing witnesses future meetings and post-legislative scrutiny of the Community Empowerment Scotland Act 2015. And lastly, item 8 is consideration of a letter from the Finance and Constitution Committee on impact of Brexit on devolution. As we are meeting remotely, rather than asking whether everyone agrees, I will instead ask if anyone objects. If there is silence, I will assume you are content. Does anyone object? Thank you very much. In that case, that is agreed. Items 5, 6, 7 and 8 will be taken in private. At agenda item 2, the committee will take evidence on building regulations and fire safety in Scotland, zero valued homes. This session forms part of the committee's ongoing work to monitor the Scottish Government's response to the tragic events which occurred in Grenfell in 2017 and related issues. This focuses mainly on issues with cladding and other external wall systems in apartment buildings. And I welcome to today's meeting Malcolm MacLeod, Director of National House Building Council Scotland, Christine Geiger, President of the Royal Incorporation of Architects in Scotland, RIAS, and Professor John Cole, CBE, Chair of Building Standards Compliance and Enforcement Review Panel. I'm grateful to you all for taking time to answer our questions today. For information, we've allocated up to an hour and a half for this session. We will move on to questions in a moment after some technical information in relation to the handling of questions. For the benefit of broadcasting, there's a pre-arranged order and I will call each member in turn to ask their questions for a block of up to 9 minutes. It would also help broadcasting if members could indicate who in the panel their questions are addressed to. We may have a short amount of time for supplementary questions at the end. For those on the panel, please indicate clearly if you wish to answer the question, for instance, by raising your hand, which I am able to see in the monitor, and don't feel the need to answer every question fully if your views are in line with points already made. Please could everyone give broadcasting staff a second to operate your microphones before you speak. Thank you for that. We will now move on to questions. And I'll begin by asking the panel, how have we reached a situation where the fire safety of flats in some brand new buildings in such doubt that lenders will not provide mortgages for buyers without extensive investigations being carried out? And I wonder if Malcolm MacLeod, you would like to start that one off?
Thank you, Convener. Firstly, thank you for inviting me along today to provide evidence to the committee. Although I'm the Director of NHBC in Scotland, I was asked to contribute today in a previous capacity as Chair of the Chartered Institute of Building, and that is what I'm quite happy to do. As you've stated, I was told that today's meeting would be looking into high-rise and to cladding issues associated with that, and I had submitted a short paper, albeit late in the day, yesterday to the committee clerk, and I don't know if that's been circulated or not. But in summary, the paper refers to deficiencies in my view, in how materials are determined and components are determined to be fit for purpose, and also the competency and experience of all participants in the design, the procurement, approval and construction processes associated with these types of projects. The paper goes into a little bit more detail on that, but basically these are the kind of principal areas that are covered in that paper, which in my view kind of contribute to the problems that have emerged and have resulted in the EWS1 form being used and circulated.
This has been going on for some time now, and you would have thought that all the new builders would have been up to date with what was going on, what they were they were meant to be doing? Why do you think we've got to this stage that, lenders just will not, in many cases, accept what's there in front of them?
Well, I can't speak on behalf of lenders. I mean, I think you've had the evidence from them before. I'm unfortunately can't speak on their behalf, although I'm aware of the problem. The building industry, the construction process, be it the design right through to the handed over, is a very fragmented process with many players involved in that. And that's part of the problem, that there's no single individual that takes control of that from conception right the way through to completion, generally speaking. That's the case these days. So when you have a fragmented process with that, with many individual companies, organisations, individuals involved in it, unfortunately, things do not often go to plan. And as I said, the areas I've highlighted start off with looking at the design, and be that the design or be it the construction process, and focusing on firstly the competency of who's procuring that design. And that generally is the owner of the building. And do they have the experience, the knowledge, the competency, or the professional assistance, the proper professional assistance to properly design and properly procure what they're seeking? Then the designer, does the designer have that competence and experience in terms of the specific project they've been asked to look at? Do the building control approval people have that competency to check that what is being put forward actually complies with the regulations? And in designing the project, are the materials, components, and systems that are being proposed, are they fit for purpose? And not only are they fit for purpose, how do these components interface with each other? And at the junctions where they interface, are they fit for purpose? Have they been properly designed? And then moving on to the construction process, how are these checked in situ? You know, has it been material substitution? Some of these materials look identical, but do not give the same performance levels. And how is that checked on site and certified? And how are they installed? Are the people installing them? Have they been trained properly? Do they have the proper competence and knowledge to do that? And this continues all the way through to when the building is occupied and finished. How is it then maintained? And is there a proper strategy for maintaining and looking after that building to make sure that the design and the construction process does what it should do in terms of fire protection and fire prevention, etc., and is not interfered with through maintenance or subsequent improvement works?
Yeah.
You know, so that's the basis of my paper.
Yes. I'm going to ask you another question, then I'm going to ask the other two panellists the same two questions. Are you satisfied that the vast majority of Scotland's new homes are well designed, built and compliant with the building standards, or do you think that the issue of zero-valued homes is principally an issue for the financial service industry, or there's truly a problem with how we design, build and regulate construction in Scotland?
There's quite a few kind of questions within that.
Do you think it's a financial issue or finance industry issue, or do you think there's an issue with how we do things?
There's a bit of both, but the EWS one form is definitely a financial one, driven by the both the surveying and financial institutions, where the valuation surveyors are not confident in providing a value for a building where they're not able to traditionally survey that building, as it would with a low-rise building where access is relatively easily gained to parts of that building, and there's general confidence in that the construction materials and components used are quite traditional. So for low-rise buildings and low-rise flats, it's not generally a problem. And the issues here tend to be with the high-rise buildings where maybe materials and components used are not traditional. They're relatively new sometimes. Systems are built are not new, and the surveyors who are carrying out the valuations potentially don't have the confidence, knowledge or experience to properly assess and survey these buildings to put a valuation on it. So my understanding of the zero valuation is they're putting a zero valuation on there as a check to say it's not really zero value, but we're not confident in the construction here and we need more information before we can move forward and provide a proper valuation for it.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm abusing my position as convener here and going over my time, but can I ask Christine the same questions as I've just asked Malcolm there, what her view is?
Thank you, convener. It's a pleasure to be here today and to be giving evidence for you. Thank you for the invitation. We also submitted evidence in advance, which I hope everyone's had a chance to look at. And we also submitted evidence on the 22nd of September. So it's building on that a little bit more. I think it's hard to touch on all those things in one answer, if I'm really honest. It is a very complex situation. There are many players involved. I think one of the biggest factors for me, from our perspective, is that over the last 20 years or so, the traditional role essentially in the design team structure has been quite eroded. Design and build contracts have become very prevalent in large scale public sector work, and especially in developer led housing schemes, for example. So the consultant's role has become very limited during the site works. Therefore, the contractual obligations are to the contractors as their employers, and the architect, for example, may not be aware of changes during construction. So to simplify that, they're not in a position to issue certificates such as the EWS1 forms competently, for example. So there's a lot of factors at play within the industry as a whole, and how the traditional role of the design team has kind of evolved, one could say, or eroded in another sense. And I think the reason behind this change and the kind of elephant in the room is cost, essentially. So the reason behind that change is cost. It's a narrowing down of expenditure at that stage in construction, essentially. And as a consequence, we're in a position where no one can issue the certification that's required, which we're talking about today in terms of zero value homes and mortgaging. So ultimately, it's the consumer that suffers, but cost is the main factor. In the paper that we submitted on the 6th, we proposed two solutions, because there's two ways of looking at this. There's new properties moving forward, and how we look at actually what we can put in place to mitigate this moving forward in terms of new build. And there's also the problem with the existing building stock, and EWS1 forms obviously apply to that. So I think in terms of there was a very loaded question in there in terms of maybe where blame lies, or you know, how we actually get to the nub of this issue. And I think it's very tricky. In terms of new build, there's a threefold solution essentially. We can improve site inspections by the professional design teams, almost going back to the traditional roles route. The key elements can be checked. Compliance with the building regulations as work progresses, and an onerous inspection scheme can be put in place from the outset. And I think that's one thing relating to the EWS1 forms, which is an issue. They can often, they've appeared once the building is complete. They're a retrospective application of compliance. And I think that's where the onerous feeling around those forms lies, essentially, because you're being asked to certify something that you may have not had a robust process of inspection during the works or involvement in, and therefore that it's asking a huge amount of the certifier to sign that form. Going back to cost, this links back into industry and what's happening in the insurance market. And for architects signing those forms, the problem is the fact that you're not insured to do so, and it is almost impossible to gain insurance to do so. So there's a market failure there slightly, not in terms of architect failure, but in terms of that cost element coming back in terms of certification and inspection. So I think it's all about the involvement of the design team on site, the expectation from the outset being outlined so that there can be a robust process of inspection built into the system of procurement, built into the appointment, that guarantees design team involvement and independent scrutiny. Because I think one of the biggest things that's happening through design and build is that there's no third party scrutiny. Now, there are schemes in place such as the NHBC, which has been mentioned, and their insurance backed schemes, which are obviously of very high quality. And greater use of third-party quality control and insurance-based schemes definitely, you know, should be considered. And however, that also comes with a cost. So it's balancing all these things. And on top of this, there's enhanced statutory scrutiny. The Scottish Government's Building Standards Division are currently examining expanded compliance management scheme with a range of stakeholder involvement, which is fantastic to see, including the RIS. And we really support that proposal, especially moving forward. It's more appropriate for new build, but that would work more effectively, essentially, alongside greater use of third-party control and insurance schemes and continuing design responsibility by the professional design team. So those things are linked in order to kind of manage the situation on new build. In terms of going forward, there is always a cost associated with these things. And again, it's coming back to that elephant in the room, that there's cost involved, and it's how that's managed moving forward to get the most out of that in order for owners to be able to sell properties because of the mortgage concerns linked to it, essentially.
Okay, thank you for that. There was a lot in that answer. Unfortunately, I've run out of time, but I'd like Professor Cole, could you briefly, just at this stage, maybe try and respond to those questions? I'm sure my colleagues are going to be asking you many more questions along the same lines.
Yes, I think my two colleagues have actually covered most of the key points that I would like to make. Just to reiterate, there's four things that need to happen to make a building safe. The first thing is that we need to have a set of building standards that everybody understands. And it's clear that in the past there has been confusion in relation to the application of some materials, and particular confusion about the Class O allocation as opposed to the European standards A1 and A2 in relation to whether a material is combustible or not. And that confusion has been throughout the industry, and has led to lots of buildings being built across the UK, including Scotland, which contain buildings, materials which should not have been used, which are unfortunately combustible. And that confusion has been within the industry. And that, so I know that building control and building standards have taken steps to try and eradicate that and improve the information and clarity. And that's one of the key factors which is happening now. The second thing is you need to design it properly. And that designer is reliant on understanding of those standards. So they need to be properly translated into a design which is then built. And the ability of the construction industry then to translate that design into a building following exactly what is prescribed has changed to some degree, because we're now having increasingly design of detailed components by subcontractors whose designability is not always checked or scrutinised. And the original designer quite often isn't the person who's designing some of the detailed elements. And you can see in the Grenfell inquiry that the detailed design fabrication of the system was actually done by the subcontractor, not by the architect themselves. And you're not getting enough scrutiny and detailed scrutiny of that by the original designer. The fourth thing then is the competence of the construction team to actually build it. And we have real concerns, as expressed in some of the reports I've done earlier, about the quality of the construction industry tradesmen, the training of those to actually build systems. Quite often they're self-employed subcontractors who come on board for a scheme and have not necessarily had training. In the Grenfell project again, the subcontractors employed labourers who were being trained on the day to install the cladding, and that was their first time doing that, which is really quite crazy when you think about the importance of these components. So that issue then, the final issue, I suppose, is the role of the building standards. And there has been an assumption, I'm afraid, by many people that their inspections have been sufficient in the past to confirm that buildings are safe. They aren't, because they're just not frequent enough and they're not detailed enough. And I know that the building standards are taking significant steps now to look at the compliance plan. And I was involved, as some of you know, in the review of the compliance and enforcement of building standards in Scotland. And I've made a wide range of recommendations, which I think have been taken forward by the Futures Board, which has been set up by the government to review and consider the implementation of those recommendations. But that's going to take some time, because we need to change a whole culture across the industry. I think this has been a real scare to us. It's terrible. There's been a tragedy like Granville, which has allowed us to see this, but there has been a sloppiness in the industry, and this fragmented state where you do not have carrying through from design to construction is now an absolute key issue. That break in responsibility and architects unfortunately stepping back due to the appointment situation from the construction inspection has been a major failing, because not only does it mean that you don't get that independent scrutiny on behalf of the client, but also architects' profession as a whole become more de-skilled because they're not seeing it actually being built on site. They're only seeing their designs on drawing boards. And that is a terrible situation. Architecture only happens on site. It doesn't happen on a drawing board. It has to be how it's implemented, and that's how people learn about what their design reflects like on site and makes changes and improvements as they go back to the drawing board for the next project. So there's been failures right across the system. And I think we're taking some steps to do it, but it's going to take quite a while to get the culture changed to a position where we can rely on the work being absolutely correct.
Okay, thank you for that. Just before I move on to the next speaker, we've been informed that Annie Wales isn't well today, so I want to thank her for giving me her 9 minutes. So I managed to get all those questions in. So Alexander Stewart will be next for questions.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Back in 2017, this committee indicated that they had some concerns about the lack of clerk of works that were being employed when it came to construction across the sector. And we published a report back in 2017 asking for greater use of clerk of works. So can I ask probably Professor Cole and Mr. McLeod, what has happened since then? Have we seen a recent increase in employment of clerk of works? And how might, if that hasn't happened, how that might be further encouraged to ensure that we do have these professionals on site that are examining and scrutinising the work that is being carried out? Because that has been a major issue in the past. It would be good to get an update as to where we see ourselves now. So, Professor Cole first and Mr. McLeod.
Yeah. Just to come in on that, I couldn't agree more with you that the failure in recent projects and over recent decades to employ clerk of works has been a major contribution to the reduction in quality, which I think has happened across construction. It's very difficult to say whether there have been significant changes. From my perspective, people in Scotland will know better as to whether the recommendations that I made in the original Edinburgh Schools report and subsequent reports that clerks of works were a critical part of the inspection regime. I'm not sure how that has changed in Scotland, but it is necessary to change. I know the Scottish Government issued guidance saying that all buildings and it should have appropriate inspection and independent scrutiny on site. I do know that some local authorities have increased and recruited more clerks of works. I don't know how big that improvement has been, but one of the major problems has been with the reduction in the use of clerk of works, the availability of skilled and experienced clerk of works in the industry is much less than it was. So there will be difficulty finding clerk of works who do the job properly. The second thing is that quite often clerk of works are being appointed on only a very temporary basis. For example, in the Granville project, again, you'll see that the clerk of works, who acted as an independent inspector, was only there for half a day a week. Now, it's no use of clerk of works being there after things are closed in. It's the problems with the failures in these buildings are in areas which are out of sight once the finish has been applied, particularly in cladding areas. So you need to have people there on a regular basis, and for the people who are carrying out the work to know that they're under regular scrutiny. So I'm not sure that it can have moved forward that much because, I say, of this issue of the scarcity of people with the right experience, and also the lack now of courses in training of clerks of works. But there has been certainly a revival of awareness of the need for clerk of works across the UK. So that's a good sign. How much time it will take to build up that cadre of people with the competence to do that, to meet all of the needs, and whether, to go back to what the president of the RIAS said, whether clients are prepared to pay appropriately for that quality inspection. This is unfortunately what's been happening on a regular basis, that cuts are made in initial capital investment and you pay for them in the longer term, and society as a whole is paying big time for that lack of quality investment originally. And I think the local government and public sector ought to be leaders in this regard and ensure that the carports are being used. So I'm not in a position to say precisely what has changed, but you're absolutely correct that I think it's one of the key issues that needs to change.
Thank you. Mr. McLeod, do you have any comments on that?
Yeah, it's a bit of some comments. I think I echo what John Cole's saying, and I personally don't see very many projects these days with independent clerk of works being employed. And I think just to go back to some of the comments made by Christina, that I'm old enough, and in previous roles I've been project managing large projects, which were procured by what's called the single stage selective tendering route. And that was the traditional way that projects used to be procured, where you would employ an architect, you would employ a surveyor, an engineer, mechanical engineer, etc. And part of that overall team of consultants, you would also employ a clerk of works. But you know, all these things, as has been stated, comes with costs, and we're driven and kind of pushed by the owner of the building, who, you know, would be being advised to seek and procure these services for the long-term benefit of the project. Now, over time, unfortunately, the procurement routes have changed. And as Christina said, we are focusing more on design and build type of procurement routes, where it's kind of taken away the traditional role of some of these consultants and professionals that we used to have. And the only kind of people that, the only organisations now that commonly use clerk of works tend to be social housing providers such as housing associations, where they seem to have in-house directly employed clerk of works for their own projects. So they obviously value the contribution and the input of that individual in these projects to make sure things have been done correctly on site. So it's a valuable role, but there's not very many of them about. The problems were well put by John Cole in terms of the, you know, skills, they need to build that up and the time that would take. But unfortunately, I think at the moment they are a bit short on the ground.
And if I can ask Christina to follow on from that, do you believe then, Christina, that that has had a detrimental effect when it comes to your role with the architect in supporting some of these contracts and projects that are going forward?
Thank you. I mean, it's hard to comment whether it's had a detrimental effect. I think that, you know, I don't have enough evidence to hand to comment on that aspect. I think it's, in terms of traditional forms of procurement, you know, the design team, the architect, the engineer, the surveyor, the clerk of works will have a significant level of involvement on site. The architect, for example, would visit regularly, often weekly, inspect elements, and for example, structure might include fire safety measures and kind of seeing those key elements that have been, you know, spoken about already today. On more complex projects, there's likely to be a clerk of works who provide that additional level of scrutiny. And I think that the key thing in this is the independent scrutiny, the third party there to kind of review, to scrutinise and to notice things as they're happening. And I think the difficulty is, and it's been brought up by everyone today, I believe, in that it's client or developer driven, and it's actually having that third party independent scrutiny, which is really important. And when you have a design team, you know, you have that third party scrutiny, but you also have, there's more than one person in the team. You know, things are discussed, the problems are shared. It's a team essentially, and I think it's not to dilute the process by any means, having a design team involved. It just adds that expertise throughout the construction phase, which is critical. And I think a clerk of works is key, especially, as I said, on more complex projects. The reason I say this is this, again, comes back to cost and not making the process so onerous that it's completely unaffordable. There needs to be a measure, a balance in there. But I think, you know, the role of the clerk of works is absolutely key alongside you know, the traditional role of architect on site. And I think it's that combination, and it's not to harp back on about a traditional role or, you know, protection of architects using, it's actually to do with the delivery of quality. And I completely agree with Professor Dronco. I think the difficulty that the industry is facing is that throughout the changes that have happened over the last, even say 20 years or so, you know, there's been a resultant skills kind of knock-on effect, essentially, you know, that involvement in site and construction professionals, you know, across the board, not just architects. And I think it's time to kind of reinvest in that, deliver quality first, involve the design team, have the oversight that's required, you know, that's relatable to the scale and complexity of the project, so that, yes, there's a cost involved, but it's essentially, it's justified in terms of actually the quality that's coming out. And this applies more to new build than, you know, we're getting away a little bit from existing building stock because that's built. But I think in terms of how we move forward, it's getting that process in place in terms of the design team involvement and the procurement route in order to deliver quality moving forward, which is key. And I think the level of roles in that from the design team should be equated to the complexity of the project. And there's probably, it's difficult to see how that's measured at this point, but I think the more scrutiny, especially if it's independent or third party, it results in higher quality of delivery, essentially.
Thank you, Convener. That concludes my questions.
Thank you very much, Alexander. Thank you. Polly McNeil.
Thank you very much, Convener. I think Christina said that consumers in some cases have paid quite a high price. Many buildings in Glasgow, where they'd be effectively zero valued and such horrendous defects in the buildings, very, very hard for the consumer to come back on. Malcolm McLeod, I thought that the report that you gave to the committee it's quite kind of damning on the system, the competence of key players, no single person taking control, fragmented and confusing. So, first of all, I'd like to ask Malcolm, why do you think it's been allowed to go on for so long? And given that, is the only way to provide protection for consumers and to make sure that no one falls through the gap again, to move to independent mandatory ongoing inspection? And what is wrong to going back to the old scheme? Because if we don't have a foolproof system, then there are going to be buildings that are going to fall through this problem again. Thank you.
Thank you, Pauline. Personally, I don't think there's anything wrong with going back to the old system. It worked in its day, and there's no reason it can't work again without some kind of refinement. I think over time, some of the issues that have been mentioned have led to where we are today. Skills, lack of confidence, lack of experience, it led to gradually bringing in the contractor or the builder to assist with the design. And that's always been the case. I mean, on site, you would very, very often, even under the traditional system, find that the architect or surveyor had not taken account of everything. And then the input was required from the builder to resolve that problem. As Christina said, you tended to work as a team, and okay, it may have attracted some more cost, but it would have been resolved on site, and everyone would have been involved in the way it was resolved. Over time, the involvement of the builder and contractor has grown and outstripped the kind of involvement of the design team to an extent. And that is primarily, in my view, and I might be wrong, but it's been a combination of things such as lack of experience and confidence within the design team. And I'm not being critical of the design team, it's just, you know, as John Cole alluded to, the less time you spend on site, the less time you spend within the contracting environment, the less knowledge you'll have of the actual build process. The design process is a separate kind of issue here. So the building and contracting side have kind of grown in terms of the procurement route. They've then taken control of design, part of the design on site.
My question was, given what you said in your own paper, why has this been allowed to go on for so long? I mean, I could cite building after building in Glasgow where the failure for, as Alexander puts, a clerk of work scrutiny from beginning to end has resulted in harbour developments you might be familiar with as one example.
Yeah.
How, and then that was like 15 years ago. How do you think it's taken so long?
Yeah, it really does boil down to cost and the client's decisions. I mean, the whole project starts with someone who owns the land or owns the building and wants to do something with it, and they then decide how to progress that. And historically, you would have a design team with a clerk of works, but over time, costs have been eroded, development costs have been honed in, and value engineering is a term that's often used. And I've heard developers talking about not needing a surveyor, not needing an architect, not needing a clerk of works, because they're costs, and they don't seem to value the benefits that come with these costs. So the original decision in terms of how the job is procured and how it's designed lies with that owner or developer, and they're the ones that make these decisions. And as Christina said, unfortunately, I think cost has kind of pushed them down this path where now it's beginning to emerge. And it does take a lot of time for these things to come to light. Now problems are beginning to emerge that we're starting to see in terms of construction quality. And what I would say is that most of the issues tend to be in the construction side. The design, generally speaking, is okay. It's done in an environment where you're drawing a plan or you're on a CAD system doing a design. It's approved by the local authority, building control. And that process tends to be relatively straightforward. But where it does go wrong is on site, where it's actually been put together then, because on site they're then trying to assemble a building and the design, there may be some flaws in that, there might be some issues where materials meet other materials. And that then is resolved on site by the builder generally, working with the subcontractors. And as Christina said, the design team quite often are not involved in that. So these things are developed over time. And unfortunately, cost is part of it, but it does need a shift in culture and I think an appreciation by whoever is investing in that development of the impact of not having that control over the length of the project.
So, my second question to the panel is, how should remedial work on block clads and potentially combustible clads have been taken forward? And do you have any views on how work should be prioritised, certified, undertaken, and importantly paid for, because obviously many consumers have been left where the building was compliant at the time. And who's best to start that one?
Professor
Cole,
do you want?
Or Professor
Cole. Question, unfortunately, my hearing wasn't clear.
So I'm asking how remedial work on blocks that are clad with potentially combustible cladding should be taken forward, and if you have any views on what should be prioritised and in fact how it should be paid for. So, I mean, a good example would be the Glasgow Harbour development where it was compliant at the time, but they are potentially left with the bill, or the remedial work does need to be done, or they can't sell the properties. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Well, it's hard to say how it should be paid for. I think inevitably with some situations there's going to have to be some government intervention and support, which we already have in across the UK. The prioritisation would clearly be those buildings which are highest risk, and I think what we need to develop is an absolute standardised system which is used by all groups of people who are carrying out these investigations of existing properties, that they do carry it out in a systematic and risk-based process, so that they move from the initial assessment to further in-depth and intrusive assessments until they discover the full extent, if there are any problems or whether they need to carry out further investigations. The higher the buildings, the more vulnerable the group of people in those buildings. The problems of access, those buildings which have compromised means of escape, the other provision within the building, whether there's any other fire suppression systems in the building, all of those considerations would have an impact on the risk, the priority that you'd apply to the buildings that you should start to look at, and whether they should get remedial treatment. I think this issue, though, about having a standardised approach, because it is very difficult, as Christine was saying earlier, that the architects are finding it impossible to get insurance to carry out these tests. And again, I'd be anxious about the effectiveness of any of these tests particularly on very tall buildings, and how people are examining, particularly the upper floors, you know, inaccessible buildings and a high wind on the outside. The most liable problems are going to be the use of combustible insulation, which has tend to be widely used, unfortunately, and also the missing or inappropriate fitting of cavity barriers, which rely very much on the quality of the tradesmen who install them and the supervision of those teams. And I think this is where the problems have lain. So really, when you've examined sufficient to give you reassurance that the quality of workmanship is good, you need to look at the top and bottom of the building, because the applications may well be different. But you need to do some sort of prioritised risk-based assessment, and it should be standardised across the industry so that different people aren't coming up with different assessments.
Thank you very much.
Christina, do you want to come in on this?
Yes, that would be really helpful. Thank you. I completely agree with Professor John Cole. I mean, the cost is a difficult side of things. I think there's kind of two sides to this. There are properties that may have equity, and therefore, you know, there's value and money spent. Mm. It's very, very hard on owners, but it may be able to be recouped. But there are properties, however, it will push into negative equity. So it's very hard to look at this across the board. But I think in terms of the existing buildings, the difficulty, you know, it's in the level of investigation required. You know, as Professor John Cole said, it's the top, the bottom, the middle. It's everywhere there should be a fire, a cavity barrier. And it's the difficulty is, I suppose, is the level of investigation that would be required on an existing building. And I think the difficulty with the EWS1 form is that it looks like something that can be signed, but actually for thorough investigation, it is quite an undertaking to actually competently say, or the person signing it competently be satisfied that their primary materials and the external envelope are of limited combustibility. And that's a very big task. And again, it comes down to cost. So it's very, very hard for house owners. It's very, very hard for that zero rated kind of category. But in terms of moving forward, these problems have been exposed by the industry. You know, there's a light on them at the moment, and it's finding a way to move forward. And in our evidence submitted previously, we kind of looked at this in terms of actually, what can we do with what we've got now? How do we move forward? And looking at the forms, I think, you know, essentially an approved code of practice, an ACOP, around how the form should be used, how inspections should be carried out, so that there's an industry-wide level, as Professor John Cole said, in terms of how we're looking at this. And I think without that, there's going to be a variation in how these forms are treated, and also how the industry moves forward with it. There needs to be a code of practice in terms of actually how this is being looked at across the board to ground the process, essentially. And I think that then, you know, can allow discussions on prioritisation and how things are funded to move forward, because it'll be more quantifiable in terms of the work required for the types of building.
Okay, thank you very much. Gail Ross.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. Thank you for joining us. I must say, a lot of evidence that I've heard so far this morning has actually been really, really concerning. We've heard about lack of ongoing monitoring, cost cutting, need for maybe different regulations, skills shortages, and well, the need for a code of practice. I mean, I guess what I would like to know is, and as we go on in the evidence, that, you know, more and more comes out about the worrying aspect of this, do we have any idea about how many buildings in Scotland may be affected? Because we've gone on from not just talking about cladding in high-rise buildings, but now we're talking about insulation and all these different things. I mean, that could affect untold amounts of buildings. And as was mentioned, there's going to be huge cost in trying to find that out. But how much importance do you think we should be putting on finding out where these buildings are?
Who to, Gail?
Malcolm first, yep.
Yeah, I think obviously it's very important to find out where the buildings are and how many there are. And I may be incorrect, but I thought that there had been an audit carried out by the local authorities through the building control departments to identify where these were in Scotland and the number of them and the type of construction. So I believe if that was done, then I believe that that information is already in place. And it then goes back to prioritising them along the lines suggested by Gail and John, and then deciding how best to approach these. Some of these will be in private ownership, no doubt, and some may be in public ownership through social housing providers, through housing associations or local authorities. But I believe that information may already be in the possession of the government.
So we've spoken already about the problems that, and you mentioned just now, homeowners and those that are in private ownership, and the costs of doing any remedial works as necessary. How would local authorities, do you think, go about that? Because, well, we've just done budget scrutiny on local authorities, and we're all very aware of the budgetary constraints on them at the moment. So how would you say that could be alleviated or indeed funded? I'll just go back to you, Malcolm, because you're still on my screen.
Well, that's a good one, because I'm afraid I'm not able to give you any direction or guidance in that one. need to speak to the finance secretary. There is no real and simple answer to this. I mean, in terms of the private sector, you know, and as already previously stated, when they were constructed, they were constructed in good faith and in compliance with all the regulations and statutory requirements in place at that time. So you've got the odd builder. I mean, we do have examples of Taylor Wimpey and Cala undertaking works to some of their projects in Glasgow to resolve these issues. But other builders are saying, well, nothing to do with us because we did everything we should at that time. And unfortunately, I don't have a resolution to that. In terms of the housing associations, then they're going to have to maybe look at the reserves or maybe just try to factor it into future maintenance programmes to do these things. In the meantime, obviously, there will be people in homes who are rightly concerned that their home might not be safe in the event of a fire. And that is quite worrying. Yeah. And obviously, there are factors that can be put in place in terms of fire wardens, etc. But again, that's quite a costly exercise, and it doesn't really alleviate these concerns fully. But I'm sorry, I don't have an answer in terms of where the money is going to come from the problem.
Thanks, Malcolm. Anyone else? Christina?
Christina.
Thanks, Gail. I don't actually have any answers in terms of the finance, unfortunately. Sorry, it is a very difficult area of the conversation. And I just wanted to pick up on, you're right, there is a lot of issues being raised today. But in terms of the Scottish Building Regulations, essentially, they've been quite responsive over the years. For example, in 2005, they responded to the lessons learnt at Garnet Court. And cladding and insulation in high-rise domestic buildings is required to either be made of non-combustible materials or that the whole cladding system is subject to a stringent fire test. So we're actually, in Scotland, we've got quite a robust system. It's different to England. And I think that's, you know, that's to be looked on positively at the moment. You know, it's not perfect by any means, but the underlying science around it is sound. And there are investigations and conversations going on at the moment about how it can be improved. So I think that's a positive thing. It's not perfect, but it's positive. And I think it's about how we work with that to ensure that we design and manage the work robustly in terms of new build going forward, as I've mentioned, and the existing building problem that we have now. So I think it is quite daunting to have all of this exposed. I think there's a number of conversations it brings up around materials, what materials should we be using. But I think it's also very difficult because it shone a light on cladding, whereas actually cladding can offer reduced build times, reduced cost, higher performance in terms of sustainability. So we're looking at it, you know, as almost a villain in the circumstances, but I think it's very difficult because it can be used in many forms across many sectors in many different ways. And I think especially in terms of the existing building stock and sustainability, we're looking at cladding systems to improve performance of housing to help tackle fuel poverty. So I think it's really important when we're discussing this to separate out the problems with our existing building fabric and how we support homeowners, and actually how we move forward as a building industry with the systems that we have in place that, you know, we can actually work with to ensure, you know, a robust delivery for homeowners moving forward, but also with public buildings, because something that's come up quite a lot in discussions today is risk and essentially, you know, what is a high risk building. And we often talk about housing high rise. The forms that have come in are now looking at lower level developments as well. But I think public buildings also need to be looked at. You know, there is a wider conversation that needs to happen. But I think there is a positive awareness about it now. It's just the mechanism in which, you know, something has to happen, which is important. But the point that I wanted to make is the system in Scotland, the building control system essentially allows a framework for us to work with. In England, they are looking through how to improve their system with a building safety bill, introducing more onerous roles, introducing new roles. And actually, why don't we develop in Scotland our existing Scottish system, essentially, of preemptive warrants, which the building control system already allows for, in conjunction with the proposed enhanced compliance regime, which is being talked about at the moment, and potentially design team involvement moving forward and that procurement system becoming more robust. It's learning from what we've got, learning from the mistakes, and actually positively moving forward. So I'm trying to, it is the subject at hand is very concerning, but what I'm trying to tease out, I suppose, is that actually it's about learning from where we are and what we can work with, rather than adding in tiers of complexity to actually maybe dilute the process moving forward. I hope that's helpful.
Well, you've certainly put a much more positive angle on it, so thank you very much. Thanks, convener.
Okay, thank you very much. Andy?
Thank you very much, convener. Thanks to the panel for coming along. It's a very useful session. At our last session, I think with the minister in September this year, I highlighted the fact that I've been working with surveyors and lawyers for over a year on this problem. And speaking to a few surveyors, they have identified 20 to 30 buildings in Scotland that are fundamentally not compliant with building standards that were in place at the time of construction. They found EWS forms signed with an option A1 for buildings that were fundamentally dangerous, they describe them, and they've discovered a lot of fraudulent EWS forms in circulation. So we do have a problem with buildings that were not built in compliance with standards and which are now fundamentally dangerous. Now, we're trying to look in this session at, you know, what lies deeper behind this rather than the immediate problem. And so the one question I have is Christina, maybe, you know, one or two of you have talked about working on behalf of clients, but of course, with a social housing provider, of course, the Social Housing Association is the client. They are the builder, and a clerk of works will look after their interests. But we have a lot of speculative build in Scotland where the owner is the developer. It's only later that they're going to sell it to somebody. And that gives us the problem we've got today, where the owners own defective cladding, but they've no idea what's in their house because no one's told them. I mean, if you buy a car today, you'll get a 50-page, 100-page PDF of all the declarations of conformity with various regulations. You buy a house and you have no idea what's in it. So is part of the role here in much more transparency for the consumer, that they get told and they get warranted that what they're buying is actually what was meant to be built?
I think that's a really interesting. Oh, sorry.
Oh, on you go. Yeah.
Sorry, I think that's a really interesting point, and often I use that analogy, so it's good to hear it from someone else. I think in terms of information around construction, you're completely correct. The car analogy and the information available is apt. I think how to move forward on this, the things are coming into place in terms of CDM operations manuals that are handed over, you know, it is becoming more stringent, but I think that there can always be more done. And I think in order to guarantee that and pass on that information, it comes from the system that's in place. And again, in terms of new build, it's the level of inspection, the level of certification that can be put against it once it's handed over. In terms of existing buildings, it's looking at an approved code of practice, essentially, to be able to open up, certify and pass on that level of confidence to the owner. I completely agree in terms of client as developer and then passed on at a later date. It's very hard. It's probably cost comes to the fore potentially more than ever in that circumstance. And I think that's where the difficulty lies. And again, it comes down to that third party scrutiny, that independent scrutiny that possibly didn't exist in some of those instances because of the delivery mechanism, which is very, very difficult. And in retrospect, the only way, at the end of the day, the benchmark is life safety here in terms of actual, when we're talking about cost, opening up these buildings to ensure that they are compliant, we're looking at life safety. So it's very, very tricky in terms of retrospective certification, but that's where the level of opening up, the level of confidence in what you're looking at to ensure that it's compliant is really key.
Could I ask Professor Cole this question? Because, of course, you looked at Edinburgh schools. Now, in Edinburgh schools, you had a client, City of Edinburgh Council, was wanting to procure schools. And now it may have been defective in the contracts it let and all the rest of it, but ultimately it was responsible for ensuring that the buildings it was paying for were going to be to an adequate standard. Is there something that we can do? Because Christina was talking about third parties, whereas traditionally a clerk of works works for the client. Their duty of care is to the client. And so clerks of works are inappropriate where the client is the developer because they're a speculative developer. And they want to build as fast and get off-site and sell it to people who have no knowledge about what they're buying. So do we actually need fundamentally to change the procurement method so that consumers are there up front and their interests are being guaranteed all the way through the build process?
One of the, as I mentioned before, the report I did on the review of compliance and enforcement of the building standards in Scotland, and one of my proposals was that there needed to be an independent inspector acting on behalf of the client, but independent in the sense that they have a responsibility to government as well in terms of what they do. And if I refer to the situation in the south of Ireland, what we have there is a system called independent certifier, where every project there has to be appointed an independent certifier who, separate from the building standards divisions within the Republic of Ireland, has to certify full compliance with the building regulations. And as you know, in England, they're currently bringing in the new Act, which is going to require the principal designer to certify with the contractor that it fully complies in every regard with the building regulation. So, and that's in addition to the building control check, the building standard check. The other thing that you mentioned about documentation, it's been one of the really poor areas in which the industry in terms of producing accurate as-built documentation as to what is within a building. And again, I proposed quite onerous requirements in relation to the recording, both video and photographic and documentary certification of what actually goes into buildings. And I think, again, those systems need to be standardised so we can rely, like the car that we've just bought, as to what's in the walls, what's in the roof, what about the safety of the structure, etc. So I think we have a long way to go yet in relation to giving us the degree of assurance. Like you said, despite the fact that it's on a design or the fact that it's been given a warrant, there's no point in having the preemptive process unless there's a follow-up which assures of what is actually designed is actually built. And that's where the failure has been. I think, as one of the commentators said before, that most of the failings aren't necessarily in the design, although there have been design failures in specification and installation quite a lot. But most of the problems happen on site. And so it's no use having a really excellent design and a warrant approved if nobody's standing there to ensure that's actually built. So we need that degree of independent certification from the contractor. And even if it's the developer, I believe that they have to appoint an independent certifier who is acting in the law in relation to confirming that what he has seen and certified is in accordance with the rules, and therefore has a compliance which you can rely on. And I think that also is going to be a major assistance to the building standards, who don't have the resources to do that level of detailed checking. It's going to cost money, but that's money which would be good value for money in terms of protecting quality, and in the long term will work out much cheaper. So yes, there are things we can do, and I think it is important that degree of professional integrity that is required of an architect, and used to be a part of an architect in terms of signing certificates, that they confirmed that it was in compliance. We need to have somebody saying that who is not acting on the instructions of the contractor. And if the developer is a contractor, quite often there is a conflict of interest. So we need to bring that professional element into the process. You know, doctors would act in the same way. You know, they have to act with professional integrity. Designers of buildings should do as well, because we can impact so much on the lives of people, as unfortunately Grenville has shown.
Okay, thank you. Just a final question from Malcolm. The National House Building Council, how many warrants do you have in Scotland, roughly?
How many warrants?
How many properties do you guarantee?
Within a cover? Across the UK, I think we're covering about 1.3 million, so it would probably be about 12% of that, roughly, so maybe 150,000, I would guess, at the moment.
Are any of those properties suffering from the quotes zero valuations problem?
I wouldn't know. I've not been made aware, although undoubtedly there might be some, but I couldn't tell you, Andy, because I really don't know.
If there were, for example, a development here in Edinburgh which has a warrant from yourselves, is under that you've insured it, and an insurance company, sorry, a mortgage company declines to lend because they're unsure about what's in it, what would your role be?
We wouldn't have a role in that. I mean, the cover that we provide in terms of insurance is against the building failing in terms of its structure or letting water in or not conforming. The main problem with the zero valuations is that the cladding systems that were used were accepted at the time as being okay. They're still performing that function in terms of keeping the weather out and making the building watertight, so they're not defective in that kind of area. What's emerged since then is that obviously there's a problem with them in terms of their combustibility and potential for flammability. So that's something that's not covered in Scotland under our warranty at the moment.
Okay, thank you, convener.
But I add something though in terms of some of the comments that we joined in terms of first the building control resources. NHBC has been trying for the last 20 years to deliver our building control service in Scotland and alleviate the problem that has been accepted in terms of resources within the building control departments, and that has not been something that's found favour with the Scottish Government. So there is a solution to help in terms of resources. And what I would say in terms of building control, and as alluded to, the problems that emerge in construction, emerge in buildings tend to be in the construction phase. And the building control department simply cannot carry out the level of detailed inspection required to make sure that the buildings as designed are constructed to meet that design and comply, because they don't have the resources. And under the current legislation, although the construction compliance plans, the actual legislation doesn't oblige them to carry out inspections. And the last survey I saw of the construction compliance plans was that there was quite a significant number of these where they were not being implemented, and that's not solely because of the building standards. It's because building owners were not making them aware of when works were starting and when to come out and actually check things. So there is still a problem with that system in terms of checking work on site to make sure it meets the building regulations.
Okay, right. Thanks very much. Keith, Are you there, mate?
Yes. Just to say, this mic cut out, it's been cutting out consistently, and I've missed quite a bit of the evidence, so apologies if I'm repeating anything. It just appears to me, I'd be interested in the panel's views on this, and it's the only real question I've got, and it's really by more of a statement. If we have a problem whereby people can't get certification, or if the certificate that's available is insufficient because it doesn't take into account, for example, flammability of the panels or the likelihood that lenders will want to lend against it, then the system's not working. And just from the evidence I have heard, it seems to be the kind of common denominator is cost. Cost saved by developers building these things. And despite the kind of usual default position of going back to the public sector, whether it's councils and building control, really should not be the case that the cost falls on those that make money out of these things, both the cost to remedy it and the cost to make sure it's done properly in future. It can't always be the public purse that pick it up because people have been cutting corners and not spending what they need to spend to make sure they're building up to standard. Would the panel agree with that?
Who would like to go first on that one? Christina?
I'm thinking about it, sorry. It's a very difficult question, and I'm sure I won't answer it in full, or possibly answer it at all, but it's very difficult, and I think who puts up the cost essentially, and how that's delivered is essentially, it's almost apart from what we've been looking at in terms of the mechanism by which we can ensure a quality of certification or a quality of delivery going forward. So unfortunately, in terms of the cost and who should put that money up, I can't really comment. It's very difficult, and I understand where you're coming from completely. I think in terms of moving forward, there needs to be a robust enough system that it doesn't happen again. And I think that it doesn't address the problem now, and I understand that in terms of what you're looking at today. But that is something that we do have control over, so I think should take real importance. But I'm sorry, I can't comment on your question with regards to who should fund this going forward. Sorry.
Malcolm.
I fully understand Keith's question. I think, like Christina, I can't really comment in detail. It's not something that we would be involved in directly. I think it's a very, very difficult one to address. I think financially, with all businesses, builders and developers being no different, they work within financial years, and they close their accounts at each year end, and that's it, they move on to the next year. And then trying to go back historically and recoup costs for something that happened a few years ago poses financial and accounting difficulties. And I'm not trying to justify that position, I'm just trying to say that's the kind of concern that we hear from time to time. But I'm sorry, I don't really have an answer for it. It's something that would have to be taken up probably with each individual developer concerned to see if there was any merit in doing that, and also to establish whether or not they would be willing to make some contribution.
Thank you. And Professor Cole.
Again, I'm afraid this is the problem that we're all looking at, and your heart goes out to those families who are in properties that they can't sell or move out of and are negative equity. I'm not sure how you could possibly go back in the system, get money from a range of developers whose interests change all the time, and people sell companies and they move on. It's going to be, it'd be very, very difficult to get it. I think morally, you're quite right. That's where the responsibility lies. Although some people would have been acting appropriately as they thought at the time, and it's due to lack of clarity as to the understanding of what they were building, which is unfortunate, but still, it probably is still happening to some degree. I agree that what we have to do, and we as an industry owe it to the public to make sure that looking forward, we don't let these things happen anymore. And government needs to put in place the appropriate checks and mechanisms to ensure that this is happening appropriately. There's no use afterwards saying who should pay for it. We shouldn't let it happen in the first place. So So it's too late now for those who have happened, and say I feel terribly sorry for those people who've been affected by it. I'd hate to be in opposition myself. But in looking forward, what we need to do is to stop it happening again. And that means investing in appropriate quality, not paying too much, but paying the right amount for projects. Less focus on cost cutting and more focus on delivering the right quality of product, the right safety of product. And that is something that the industry has to really address. And government has a role for ensuring that they do that. And that's where I feel we need to invest more in this whole issue.
Thank you. Keith. Okay, it looks like we've lost Keith again, which has been happening quite a lot this morning, unfortunately. Okay, I'd just like to ask Professor Cole a question about, and the report on building standards compliance and enforcement call for a culture change relating to risk and compliance within the wider construction industry. Have you seen any evidence of such a change? And if not, what needs to happen?
Yes, funnily enough, I have, not funnily enough, but gratefully, I've seen significant actions by a range of contractors particularly. Certainly the industry, I've been asked to give lots of talks to different groups, making them aware of the risks that we are creating in the industry by the actions that we take. And there have been actions taken. I don't think it is anywhere near wide enough. And unfortunately, the further we move away from these tragedies or the Edinburgh Schools event or the DG1 exercise in Dumfries, people's memories start to fade and the emphasis comes off. I think it's important the government and the groups working on behalf of the government, like the Futures Board, try and maintain the impetus on this. I know that within the architectural profession, and Christina might want to follow up on this, that there's a real resolution that we have to look at the role of architects and how we can help make sure that what we design is actually built despite the procurement method. And we need to look at government to say, can you change the procurement method, please? Because as the government have been largely one of the drivers of design and build process, and it's become almost a standard methodology for delivering government projects. Design and build is fine if you're going to use it, but if you're going to use it, you then have to put in place additional, almost replication of resources to ensure that the building is being independently scrutinised. And those are the two words that I used in the Edinburgh report, independent scrutiny, and that is what needs to happen in big time. And unfortunately, I don't think it's there yet. As we said, I'm not sure we have enough paperwork yet, and I don't think that necessarily changes to the procurement models have looked at how that is brought about in standard procurement. So I think there has been a change in culture to some degree, not nearly enough, and we have a long way to go, but there is positive movement and positive evidence across sectors. And I've worked with some contractors who are seeking to improve their quality systems, and that it does seem to have been received positively. I think we need to look at how people are selected and how we actually get on to lists, from both from contractors and architectural perspectives, design team perspectives, to demonstrate that we have a culture which is focused on delivering quality and how we would take methods to ensure that that's happening. Building assurance systems also need to be real rather than just office-based. Too many people use quality assurance systems as tick boxes without actually checking things on site. So we have to make that real, and we have the digital technology to do that. It can be a big change factor if used properly, but I don't think yet there's been enough investment in that either. BIM, building information map, could help us in a significant way. But again, it needs refined and made more standard across the industry. So yes, there has been some change. Whether it's enough, I don't think so as yet.
Do you think it's heading in the right direction at this stage?
Yes, I think there has been positive movements by all groups involved. My worry is that will drop off unless we make some really significant changes quicker.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Andy, you've got a brief supplementary for Malcolm.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Just to follow up my last question to Malcolm, given that I understand that there are at least 20 to 30 buildings in Scotland that are fundamentally dangerous, not built in compliance with the standards that were in place at the time they were built. Can you clarify if any of these buildings have a warranty from NHBC that you have no liability? Is that your position?
Well, I don't know the buildings that you're referring to, Andy, but I mean, I'm quite happy to take it offline, and if you want to drop me a note, I can look into that. But my understanding is that we might have some liability if there, for example, there are other claims in relation to these buildings not associated with the cladding. But I can't honestly answer your question without more detail. If you can send me the addresses or the properties concerned, then I'll happily look into it and get back to you on that point.
No, but if cladding is on a building now that is combustible,
yeah,
and was, yeah, not in compliance with standards at the time it was built, so if that's, yeah, the situation, what do you have any liability for that?
Well, we're not a statutory body. That liability for building standards and for dangerous buildings lies with the building control departments in Scotland. So if building control departments deem the building is dangerous, then they should be taking action to make sure that, you know, that people, the public, are protected. I would have to know the details if there are any. I'm sorry?
Your warranty does not cover a building that is now found to have been built with materials that are flammable and not in compliance with building standards at the time?
Generally speaking, not in Scotland. I mean, I'm saying not in Scotland because it's in the public environment. In England, where we provided building control, we have upheld some claims in relation to that problem in England, because when we provide building control as a service, we used to underwrite that with a separate insurance policy that was clearly stating that if the building didn't comply with the building regulations, then that would be a valid claim. So on that premise, buildings in England where we provided building control and have subsequently found not to comply with building regulations, these have been deemed to be valid claims in certain circumstances. But in Scotland, we've never been able to provide building control, so that element of insurance cover was never available to consumers in Scotland.
Okay, that's helpful clarity. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. And that brings us to an end of this evidence session. Can I thank the panel very much for taking part this morning and for identifying some key issues for the committee's ongoing work in this area. The panel can leave the meeting by clicking on the red telephone icon. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Okay, agenda. Excuse me, please. Agenda item 3 is to consider whether the instrument Town and Country Planning, Management of Extractive Waste and Electricity Works, EU Exit, Scotland Miscellaneous Amendments, has been laid under the appropriate procedure. I refer members to papers 3 and 4 in assisting their deliberations. Do members agree that the parliamentary procedure given to the instruments by the Scottish Government is appropriate in respect of relevant provisions made using the power to correct deficiencies in retained EU law? I invite any comments from members. Yes, we agree. Thank you. Are we agreed? Yes, that is agreed. Agenda item 4 is consideration of a negative instrument 310 as listed on the agenda, and I refer members to paper number 4. The instrument is laid under the negative procedure, which means that its provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul it. No motions to annul have been laid. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument on 27 October 2020 and determined that it did not need to draw the attention of the Parliament to the instrument on any grounds within its remit. Do members have any comments on the instrument? No.
Okay.
Nope. I invite the committee therefore to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are we agreed?
Yes.
That is agreed. Thank you very much. That concludes the public part of this meeting, and we'll resume the meeting in private in Microsoft Teams. I propose we have a 5-minute break before we resume in private. Thank you. Please accept the clerk's meeting request for the private discussion, which will be sent shortly. You can exit the meeting by clicking on the red telephone icon, and I now suspend.